welcome to worship here at Sligo Presbyterian Church on YouTube. My name is Jake Stewart. I'm a member here. Our message this morning will be delivered by our moderator, Pastor Jim Dietrich. Before we begin, a few announcements. We are collecting food for the local food bank, ShareCare. There is a container on the back porch to deposit your non-perishables, so you don't need to come in the building. It is emptied each night, the food's brought in, so that is available to you. Secondly, if you could like our YouTube channel and subscribe, with 100 users, we will be able to get a custom URL for our channel. This is the day that God has made. We are to rejoice and be glad. Hear now our call to worship. Spirit of life and love, we gather together in different ways this morning. From computer screens, from telephones, from iPads, we gather, reaching out across the wires, waving from a safe distance, to come together in community. From living room to front porch to car seat, we gather as we are able, ready to be of service to each other, to the world, ready to build the community of hope and love as we face this bright morning. We are apart, but we are together, offering our love, our commitment, our hope, and our prayers in service to one another and this world. It is a new way, but an old way, that we come together in worship today. We have been ransomed from futile things with the precious blood of Jesus. We need not fear commendation, but instead come to the throne of grace to repent boldly and trust in God's power and will to forgive and transform. Would you join with me, please, in our prayer of confession? Lord, we have been cut to the heart. We know there is nothing we can do to earn the grace we have received through Christ. We regret the times we cheapen it, accepting your gifts while neglecting your commandments. Forgive us for not loving one another. Forgive us for not sharing with others. Forgive us for going our own way and refusing to follow you. Do not let us get so focused on the headlines that we forget the good news of the gospel. Come alongside us and remind us of your word and our purpose in this world. Hear our confession, free us from guilt, open our eyes that we might see and know our Savior, alive and present with us now. Amen. God knows the concerns on our hearts and the worries on our minds. God listens and then speaks the logos of truth and mercy, grace upon grace. The risen Christ comes alongside us, grants us peace, forgives us, and sets us free. Believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
The sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a blood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear shall. But God, who called me here below, will be forever known. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm chapter 116, verses 1 through 4 and 12 through 19. I love the Lord because He hears me. He listens to my prayers. He listens to me every time I call to Him. The danger of death was all around me. The horrors of the grave closed in on me. I was filled with fear and anxiety. Then I called to the Lord. I beg you, Lord, save me. What can I offer the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will bring a wine offering to the Lord to thank him for saving me. In the assembly of all his people, I will give him what I have promised. How painful it is to the Lord when one of his people die. I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just as my mother did. You have saved me from death. I will give you a sacrifice of thanksgiving and offer my prayer to you. In the assembly of all your people, in the sanctuary of your temple in Jerusalem, I will give you what I have promised. Praise the Lord. And from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. On the same day, two of Jesus' followers were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking to each other about all the things that had happened. As they talked and discussed, Jesus himself drew near and walked along with them. They saw him, but somehow did not recognize him. Jesus said to them, "What are you talking about to each other as you walk along?" They stood still with sad faces. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have been happening there these last few days?" "What things?" he asked. "The things that happened to Jesus, son of Nazareth," they answered. "This man was a prophet and was considered by God and by all the people to be powerful in everything he said and did. Our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and he was crucified. We had hoped that he would be the one who was going to set Israel free. Besides all that, this is now the third day since it happened. Some of the women of our group surprised us. They went out at dawn to the tomb, but could not find his body. They came back saying they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he is alive. Some of our group went to the tomb and found it exactly as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are, how slow you are to believe everything the prophets said. Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and then to enter his glory?" And Jesus explained to him what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning with the books of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they held him back, saying, "Stay with us. The day is almost over and it is getting dark." So he went in to stay with them. He sat down to eat with them, took bread, and said the blessing. Then he broke the bread and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Wasn't it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" They got up at once and went back to Jerusalem, where they found 11 disciples gathered together with the others and saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." The two then explained to them what had happened on the road and how they had recognized the Lord when he broke the bread. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
We gather together for worship this day, the third Sunday of the Easter season, and we hear from God's holy word in the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter. We'll begin at verse 13 and read on through verse 35. Listen now for God's holy word. "Now on that same day, two of the disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the way, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Here ends the reading of this portion of God's holy word. May the same Spirit that guided Luke in the writing guide us now in our understanding. I've read that there is an 80-foot-tall maple tree in Milford, Connecticut, that really hasn't changed much through the years. Oh, in the spring, the leaves come out, of course, and in the fall, the leaves fall off. But there is a spot where a limb was broken off when Hurricane Gloria blew through in 1985. Other than that missing branch, the tree on Holly Avenue has looked the same for as long as anyone could remember. But that spot where the limb was blown off caused quite a stir in the neighborhood some time back. One of the residents, Claudia Boyd, looked at the tree one day and saw what looked like, to her, the face of Jesus. "It took my breath away," she recalls. "I told my friend to come over, and pretty soon we had the entire neighborhood here looking." Word spread quickly throughout the area, and before you realized it, the maple tree had become a popular attraction as car after car drove by to see the face of Christ on the tree. The drivers slowed down as they passed by, while others parked and walked through yards to see firsthand this strange apparition. Claudia, the lady who first made this discovery, described herself as someone who attends church but is not overly religious, whatever that means. Oh, she did tell a reporter, "I'm not reading the Bible all the time." The tree for Claudia is some kind of sign, though. She said, "I just think people may be able to take some hope from it." Eve Misera, another Holly Avenue neighbor, brought her 17-year-old son over to touch the tree in the hope that it might cure him from the seizures that he suffers. "You never know," Eve says. Another resident, Kathy Cornwall, says she brought her three children over to see the tree. "We have a lot of single mothers in the neighborhood," she explains, "and teenagers who have to make tough decisions in these times." Kathy also sees the face in the tree as a message of hope. She says it's like a message to have faith in ourselves and to have hope for the world. I've told you all of that to bring us to our question for the day. Where in the world do we find Jesus? That question has been asked by every generation. Where do we find Jesus, especially in times of heartache, in times of disappointment, in times when a pandemic is wreaking havoc around the globe? The residents of Milford, Connecticut, saw what looked like a face on an old tree. Some thought it was the face of Jesus and that somehow it was a message from God. In recent years, other people have reported seeing Christ's face on the side of a house, on the side of a barn, and on a town's water tower, among other places. Where do we find Jesus? Even more important, how can we be sure that Jesus is really with us when everything seems to be going wrong? What a weekend it was for the followers of Jesus. It seemed as though the bottom had fallen out. All their hopes and dreams seemed to vanish when Jesus died on the cross. They were in a state of shock and fear. Everything had happened so quickly. And then early on Easter day, the women reported seeing angels who told them that Jesus had risen. Now the disciples at first dismissed the women's report as an idle tale. But Peter and John ran to the tomb and discovered that it was indeed empty, as the women had said. They went home, amazed at what had happened. Now Luke tells us that later that day in the afternoon, two of the believers, Cleopas and an unnamed companion, were walking to Emmaus. Now, it's a town outside of Jerusalem, about 7 miles away, and it would probably take a little over 2 hours for them to make that trek. Maybe they were thinking that this would help put the events of the past week into some perspective. Maybe they could make sense out of all of it. But on the way, they met a stranger. It was actually the risen Christ, but they did not recognize him. He walked with them and asked them what they were discussing. Now, Cleopas was shocked at this question, says, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know what has been going on these days?" The risen Lord asked, "What things?" And then they answered, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all people." Surely their discouragement and their lack of faith blinded them to the risen Lord, who was standing right there beside them. That happens sometimes. It happens to you, happens to me. We can be so discouraged and depressed, so down, that we forget that finding Christ is really not that difficult. And we don't have to look at an old tree stump to find him. First of all, we find him in the pages of our Bible. Have you ever had a Sunday school teacher who made the Bible come alive for you? Have you ever been reading the Bible and come to a word or phrase that seems to have been written just to you? At such times, we're meeting the risen Lord. Now, as Cleopas and his friend continued on their way to Emmaus with Jesus, though they didn't recognize him, Jesus began to teach them what Scripture said about the Messiah. As he interpreted to them the word, they later declared that their hearts burned within them, and they began to discover who it was that walked with them. On that road to Emmaus, Jesus taught and interpreted the Scriptures to Cleopas and the other believer, and they would remember that special day for the rest of their lives. They found Jesus, first of all, in the Scriptures. And so can we. All we need to do is open the book and read. But something else happened that day. As Jesus spoke to them, they also remembered the teachings they had heard from him before. Cleopas and his friend had heard Jesus on many occasions, but now in their state of confusion, they had forgotten what he had already taught them about his suffering, death, and resurrection. There on the road to Emmaus, Jesus jogged their memory a bit, and they remembered. We also find Jesus when we remember what we have been taught in Sunday school or worship by a parent or a trusted friend. I remember doing a Vesper service at a nursing home, and one particular lady who didn't seem to be able to pay attention at all, seemed to be just in her own world. As I read the scripture, as I preached a little bit, as we sang a song or two, and then I invited everyone to say the Lord's Prayer, and like that, that woman spoke all the words loudly and clearly. Her mind may not have been clear, but it came from her heart. Words she had heard before, words she learned before. I also remember paying visits to hospitals where someone was dying, and they appeared to be in a coma or sleeping soundly, not communicating with me or the family. We would talk for a while quietly, and then I would tell the family, you know, I'd just like to share with you the 23rd Psalm. And so I'd open my Bible and I'd start to read, "The Lord is my shepherd." I can't tell you how many times the person in the bed near to death was saying those verses right along with me. Maybe not loudly, maybe not clearly, but you could see their lips moving, and you could see that they were hearing the promises of God. Our faith is strengthened when we remember what we have already learned, the stories, the hymns, the prayers. In them, we find Jesus. Now, Cleopas and his companion began to recall, remember Jesus' teachings, and they certainly felt better now than they had when they left Jerusalem hours before. When they reached their destination, it appeared that this stranger was going further. But they enjoyed his company. They wanted to hear more, so they urged him strongly to stay with them. Stay with us, they ask. Because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over. And the risen Lord agreed. They sat down for an evening meal, and it was while they were breaking bread at that table that their eyes were finally opened. They sat down with a stranger to eat, but Jesus took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them, and suddenly they knew that this wasn't a stranger at all. This was the risen Jesus. Their eyes were opened, Luke reports, and they recognized him. Jesus broke the bread and their eyes were open. That sometimes happens for us when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. We perceive the spiritual presence of the living Jesus, the Son of God, in our midst. Dr. Tom Traeger has written of a time when he had to be away from his fiancée for over a month to take his comprehensive exams in his senior year of college. Now, he was madly in love, he confesses, and having to be away from his fiancée had made him very sad and depressed. He was traveling by bus from Ithaca, New York to New Haven, Connecticut, and the bus made a stop to change drivers at Binghamton Greyhound Station. Now, that station left a lot to be desired. There was a little diner, and Traeger went in to get a cup of coffee, sat on one of those, you know, round pedestal stools with the stuffing coming out. And at the counter, he found himself seated next to an old woman. And when he sat down, the old woman looked over, nodded. She looked at him for a while and then said, "Boy, honey, you sure look depressed." And Traeger replied, "I am depressed." And he felt a tear trickle down his cheek. "What's wrong, honey?" she asked. He told her about his fiancée back home and how much he would miss her while they were apart. He showed her a picture of his fiancée, and the woman said, "Oh, I never saw such a beautiful woman." Then the woman told him that she had been married to a traveling salesman who had since passed away, and how they used to weep every time her husband had to go out of town to do his work, and how happy they were each time he came home. She said, "Marriage was wonderful. You're going to have a wonderful marriage. Everything will be just fine." She suggested he might feel better if he ate something. So she took the donut that was on her plate. She broke it in half and said simply, "Here, eat this." Just then the announcement came on over the loudspeaker and the woman said, "Oh, that's my bus. I've got to go." And she got up and went. Traeger reflects and says, "Just then, my eyes were opened, and I recognized that Christ was in that bus station." Friends, Cleopas and his companion had their eyes opened when Jesus broke the bread, and immediately they left that place and ran back to Jerusalem. They wanted to tell the other believers that they had met the risen Christ. Sisters and brothers, in these chaotic times, we can find him too. Where? Not on a tree where a branch has broken off, but we turn to our Bibles. We call to mind the hymns and the prayers we've learned, the teachings we've heard from his own lips, and also in the Lord's Supper, in the breaking of bread, the sharing of the cup, the risen Christ comes to us. Amen.
Join with me now as we pray together. God of all time and places, we cannot stop talking about the painful events we have witnessed this week. We're discussing the numbers of people killed by COVID-19. We speak constantly of the suffering brought on by this pandemic. We talk about the economic, physical, mental, spiritual and psychological distress all over the globe. We debate the merits and risks of reopening our country. We cannot turn away from the anxiety that feels ever present. We know you hear our voices and our supplications. We give thanks that you do not leave us alone. As the risen Christ comes alongside us now, we pour out our hearts, unashamed to share exactly how we feel and what we fear in this moment. We rest in your sure presence as we share with you now our thoughts and worries, our hopes and doubts. God of all time and places, tell us again the story of salvation. Remind us how you rescued us from Egypt and sustained us in the wilderness. Help us to remember that you were with us in exile and made a way to bring us home. Do not let us forget that you can use for good even that which we intend for evil. Bring to our minds the countless times you have not allowed the storms of this life to overtake us. We know you hear our voices and our supplications. We give thanks that you do not leave us alone. As the risen Christ comes alongside us now, we urge him not to leave, but instead to stay with us. We abide in your resurrected presence as we listen for your living word. Give us your guidance in this trying time. God of all time and places, having heard your word and broken bread with you, we recognize our Lord, alive and showing us the way. You do indeed make all things possible, defeating evil, overcoming death, restoring us to right relationship with you and one another. Send us to those places in deepest need of knowing that creation is redeemed and nothing can separate us from your love. Hear our voices and our shouts of praise as we proclaim, we have seen the Lord, he is risen. We are not and will never be alone. We make our prayer in the name of the one who taught us to say when we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As our service ends, I bless you with joy. May you find moments of laughter and bliss in the midst of suffering and distress. May you cherish those times, and may they sustain you. I bless you with the fruits of humility. May your humble and sacrificial actions be instrumental in preserving your community and loving your neighbors. I bless you with peace in the face of financial hardship and uncertainty. May you know the faithful presence of the God who provides. Go in peace. Wash your hands. Love your neighbors. You are not alone. Thank you.